Good evening. This is a talk about Debian virtualization, present and future, by Jan Lueber. Please, if you want to make a question or an assertion, ask for the microphone so everyone can hear you. And if you're going through this camera, that one, please crouch as in Counter-Strike games. Jan, thank you.
Thank you. So I'm here to talk about what is possible with virtualization in Debian right now and how that will change in the near future. So I want to thank every one of you to come for coming to my talk. I've been a Debian developer for only 1 year now, and so maybe I don't know all the details of the other projects, but we'll see. First, I'll talk about what virtualization is and how that compares, for example, to emulation, which different projects use which approaches, so we can see which approach and which project is best for each use case. And at the end, I want to talk about how that is usable right now in the Lenny for Debian and how that will change in the future. So why do you want to virtualize a computer? There are very many different use cases for it. At least in Debian, for a developer, it's mostly useful for testing software and networking. For others, it's mostly useful for consolidation, increasing availability and redundancy by supporting the same software, same stack on several different machines, so you can switch easily. It is also used, for example, by Amazon and other big companies for the so-called cloud computing. So we have a software stack that runs on any machine, but you don't really need to worry where it is running. You can rent the computing time by the hour. Something I haven't seen yet myself is the Follow the Sun module that is for example, global global corporations who need to have really low latency in the part of the world where currently the working hours are, but they don't want to shut down their servers, so they use virtualization to move them between the different shifts without a big downtime to another location. Yeah, something else. What are you using virtualization for? Anything interesting? So, for example, the browser to keep it separate from the rest of the system?
DNS server. If you only run DNS server on your virtual machine, somebody breaks it. So any internet-facing software, if it is in a virtual machine, and which doesn't have anything real on it, then if you get broken into, all they have had access to is your toy virtual minimal operation. And we also use SE Linux in our virtual containers. So it is very hard to break out of it, even though you compromise, say, Apache or something.
Okay. I really like to use snapshots on virtual machines. I can just say, okay, I want to make an update of something. So I can take a snapshot, which is done in 1 second or something like that. And then I put this update there, and if it works, then I can say, drop this snapshot. Otherwise, I can go back. So I really like this feature.
Containing badly behaving applications.
Yeah, we have a lot of them. So basically containing anything you don't want to have physical access to your hardware. Yeah, there are a lot of different methods to reach this. I'll go from the full virtualization over the more complex stuff to hardware emulation. So with the full system virtualization, I mean something like VMware VirtualBox, KVM, where the guest system doesn't need to know that it's being virtualized. There is para virtualization, that has been done by Xen, Elgest, and even before by UML. There's container virtualization, something like Linux vServer. Yeah, there are different terminologies, but you use it for similar use cases, so at least listed here. And you have Virtuoso OpenVZ, which supports that, and on the basic level, jails and change routes. Then there's API translation, for example, Wine, and system emulation, where you don't even need to have the hardware the guest software was written for. There is just QEMU, PPC, DOSBox, Hercules. There are a lot more in Debian. So for emulation, the host has software which replicates all the hardware that is necessary to run the software. There's advantages that you can any guest software on any hardware system, but it's really slow. So it's mostly useful for testing, not for running servers or so. But even with the emulation, it's sometimes faster than any real hardware which is available. So for example, ARM buildies on really fast AMD 64 machines are faster or have more memory than the real machines. The full system virtualization is for the same goal, but you need this to have the same architecture than the guest, except for AMD 64 and i386. So you can run unmodified guests, but it has higher complexity because the guest expects to have access to the hardware and you need to only emulate these parts of the system.
This really depends on the hardware you're running on, because if you're in an architecture that's actually designed for, like the good old mainframes, the complexity is not actually that high. But even if you're on x86, as long as the actual emulated hardware you expect is low enough, it's not significantly more complex. A very good example for that is VMware, that very carefully picked the hardware they emulated to avoid this complexity.
But it's still harder to get right than just emulating. Then we have parallel virtualization, which Xen is doing. That is the first time we tell the guest that it's running on virtual hardware, so it can cooperate. So we have lower overhead because we don't need to emulate things like disk controllers, network devices, and so on. But of course, the guest needs to be modified, so we can't run any operating system. Then we have container virtualization, which may not be virtualization at all, because we run just one kernel, but the applications see different environments. We have a minimal overhead. We have better resource sharing because we can share the page cache, we can share the memory when one guest is using less memory. But of course, we can only run one kernel, so all guests have to use the same kernel. And at least with the current implementations, the isolation is not as strict as with parallel virtualization or full virtualization. API translation, we've seen Wine, which has taken a very long time to reach the current state. So you need to re-implement full API, which is really, really complex. But you don't need to run that OS once you've re-implemented the API, so it's low overhead. So now we'll see what projects there are. There's QEMU, which is an emulator, has been around for a long time, emulates a lot of hardware for different architectures, runs on different architectures. It uses something called dynamic binary translation, which is it looks at the code which is running in the guest and translates it to native code and stores this native code somewhere else. The device library is used for Xen, KVM, for VirtualBox also. So it's some sort of base for some of the others. That already can do snapshots. It can do USB pass-through through the guests, so you can use all sorts of USB devices in your guests. And there's an additional kernel module which can accelerate the guest on x86 and AMD64 hardware. Then it's a lot faster than just emulating. There's a basic management interface that's called QEmulator. It's also available in Debian. Then we have VirtualBox. It was started by Enotech, a German company, and is now developed by Sun. It is the core of a commercial product. There's this VirtualBox OSE for open source edition. And they have a commercial edition which has more features. For example, USB pass-through is only in the commercial variant. It has some interesting features. You can use the so-called seamless windowing module, which support, so you have Windows, for example, Windows on your Linux desktop, which you don't have a Windows desktop, only the Windows.
Open source all of VirtualBox earlier this year after they acquired it from Enotech?
Only this VirtualBox open source edition, which is the core. And
so there still is a commercial VirtualBox.
You can download it for free and try it, but you are expected to buy it then. And the commercial edition also has something like RDP, access to the virtual machine, and so on. Yes. So Xen has also been around a long time, was open source from the start. It currently supports x86, AMD64, and the IA64 Itanium architecture. They started parallel virtualizing Linux, and probably started the parallel virtualization trend in Linux. And it also supports full system virtualization on modern CPUs, which have these Intel VT and AMD SVM support, which is all current CPUs. You have a small hypervisor, which starts before the kernel, then loads the Linux kernel and runs that as the so-called domain zero, which has access to all the hardware. And then you from there you start the guest systems, which are called DOMU. And they use virtual devices which run in DOM zero. And currently Red Hat is pushing for inclusion in mainline. It's for the server space probably the most mature open source version variant of virtualization. There are a lot of management tools available. You have live migration. That means if you have two systems, we can access the same disk devices. You can switch to the running machine from one to the other in less than half a second or so. So it's not noticeable to users which access these machines over the network. You can pass through PCI devices. So if you have special hardware that needs to be used in the guest, you can pass that through. And the management tools, for example, Xenman, XenTools, XenShell, Ganeti, are all available in Debian. There are currently some problems with using Xen. There is no support for the DOM0 in the current mainline kernel, and only basic support for the DOM0 for the DOMU in mainline. In the current kernels, they are merging mostly the DOMU. In 2.6.28, we'll hopefully have DOM0 support. They are switching their virtualization interface from their proprietary one to the one that is used in mainline Linux, which is ParavirtOps. That's not ready yet. The problem with using a separate hypervisor below the Linux kernel is that you don't have suspend, you don't have power saving, you can't really use it on notebooks because you lose suspend. There is the problem that 3D acceleration on the host is difficult because you also lose some direct access to the hardware. And in general, there's a lot of code duplication. They used some device drivers and ACPI stuff from Linux and copied it to the hypervisor. Then, more recently, we have KVM, which is a hypervisor completely based on Linux. It's currently supporting x86 and AMD64, but but there are supports going on for IA64 PowerPC 440, which is an embedded PowerPC and also used in some large IBM boxes. And it has support for S390, which are not yet ready. You need, in contrast to Xen, you need this hardware support, even if you use the new power virtualization stuff, which is only used to speed up I/O. The guests run as user space processes on the host with some kernel support. It of course uses QEMU to emulate all the hardware, and the company who has sponsored this development is called Huamranet, and it's now selling their first product, Solid Ice, which is some sort of desktop virtualization stuff. You run the employee's desktop on the servers and they just look at it over the network. And with the last release, Ubuntu has chosen to use KVM as their default virtualization method and only use Xen if you have no hardware support. The features are similar to QEMU, so you have the snapshotting and so on with as with QEMU. You also have live migration, as in Xen. You can swap the guest pages because they're just normal user processes. And there is a migration path for Xen users, which is an experimental project called Xena, which can run Xen guest kernels on KVM. And of course, because you're just running normal Linux, it really works well on a laptop. Also, it's compatible with real-time extensions which are currently being merged. So you can run a hard real-time Linux kernel and, for example, a Windows GUI on top. I've seen people use that for controlling welding lasers. Still some problems because it's under heavy development. They don't have stable releases, so sometimes you have regressions. The performance is not really predictable from version to version, and there are no integrated management tools yet. So if you don't want to run a whole system in virtualization, you can choose something like vServer or OpenVZ, where you only have the Linux kernel and several containers below that. Linux vServer was a community project, which has stalled in the last time a little bit. OpenVZ was first a commercial product by Parallels and is now open sourced, and they are pushing for mainline integration and are with that further along than Linux vServer. It isolates file systems, users, processes, networks, and devices per container from the other containers. So we have scheduling inside the container, and each container has limits on what sort of resources it can use. They are shared among the containers. Using this approach has some advantages compared to full virtualization, because you can just access the file system from the host. You can see all the processes on the host. Because it's just one file system, the page cache can be shared between virtual containers, so you don't need that much of memory. Can you run more guests on the same hardware compared to KVM or Xen. And it also now supports checkpointing and live migration, but it's not really as seamless as with the others, because first need to save the snapshot to disk, transfer that, and boot it on the other machine. So that it takes a lot longer than half a second. Yeah, vServer has until 2 days not been ported to the current kernel, but there now is a patch, so that may come into Lenny if it's stable enough. Now, for managing the source stuff, there has been an initiative by Red Hat, that is libvirt. It is an abstraction layer over the different virtualization projects. Supports Xen, QEMU, KVM, LXC, which is Linux containers, and OpenVZ. We have a GUI interface for managing the guests, creating guests and virtual networks. You can attach them, reboot them, access their consoles. It is split in two parts, the libvirt daemon, which runs as root, of course, and a user interface, which can connect to the daemon via various ways. Locally via dbus and policykit, over the network via SSH with different authentication methods. Also it announces the presence of servers via Avahi. Yeah, where do we stand with Debian? We right now have no Xen DOM0 kernel in Leni or in Unstable, which is a problem for all the people who installed Xen with Edge. So they have no clear update path. It is possible that you can use the old Edge kernel with the current user space. And we hope that when Xen has been integrated upstream, maybe for Leni and a half, if that will happen, we will then have a current kernel again which can run Xen DOM0. It's not yet decision, there's no decision yet whether we want to have the old Edge kernel supported in Leni or what should happen there. Then the vServer support is supported, of course, in Edge. But because until 2 days ago there was no patch, it's not yet in Leni, but it seems that it will be supported in Leni. There are OpenVZ packages in Unstable, which will probably migrate to Leni, so we have support for that. And QEMU, VirtualBox, KVM, OpenVZ, libvirt are already in Leni and are really easy to install and use. Yeah, where will that go? Xen will be merged, probably, into 6.28. OpenVZ is currently being merged step by step to the large set of changes. Then Xen, then Red Hat will continue to develop libvirt. So we'll have a consistent console to manage all the virtualization stuff. Then there's some development in QEMU going on. Don't know what their roadmap is. Perhaps somebody here knows more.
About QEMU, there are a lot of change upstream currently. They've switched from using GCC as the code generator to something called TCG, Tiny Code Generator. So it will be able to, we will be able to remove the build dependency on GCC 3.4 and support more architecture. It's also a bit faster. And so the QEMU has been in standby for a few months, but since the end of April, actually, there are a lot of new codes merged, mainly from KVM. So I hope we'll have, for Leni Plus One, support for Spark 64, guest support. That will be useful, given that Debian doesn't support Spark 32 anymore. And maybe also the para-virtualized devices like network card and hard disk.
Thank you. And in the long term, which is maybe 2 or 3 years, we will see that most of the OSs are available of aware of virtualization. So we will have a common para-virtualization interface, which can, of course, improve resource sharing, performance. You can have ballooning, which means adding and removing memory from a running guest, and maybe hopefully pass through for 3D graphics. But there's still a lot of research to do in that area. Yeah, does somebody not have ideas what will happen beside this list?
DOM0 on 2.6.28 seems very soon from my perspective as a kernel developer.
Yeah.
We've not seen any patches yet, and given what bunch of crap all that Xen code always was, it will take a while to beat it in shape. OpenVZ as is will not be in MergeLine, which actually happened in mainline is that the container folks, which is a lot of the OpenVZ folks, a lot of IBM folks, people like Eric Biedermann, who was not part of any of those projects, a little bit of the vServer folks, but not much, are actually working on basically doing everything from scratch or sometimes taking good parts of the existing solutions and do this. And this has been ongoing for at least a year and a half, if not two, and it's not really going to be finished anytime soon. That's the perspective from Colonel Lane.
The number of 2628 was from a status report from Xen developer, so that may be a bit biased. Yeah.
I'm not going to say no, but I'm going to say I would be very surprised if someone called out for link code development.
But at least there is development going on to get it better supported, or at least based on the current patches, the stuff that is currently mainline. So hopefully we will have current Xen support on the kernels again. Yeah. So that is a call for help. We need probably to do some improvement in Debian regarding virtualization. You have all the tools there, but you still need to install them, tweak stuff manually. LiveVirt will have there, but I think we can still do something to make it easier to use Debian as a platform for virtualization. Currently, most people probably use Red Hat for Xen, maybe Ubuntu for KVM, but it's not that well integrated in Debian yet. So to make that happen, we probably we really need to have more testers, at least for the power virtualization stuff, because it depends a lot on what hardware you have. Some bugs are only visible on one processor with a specific guest, so it's not really possible for one or two developers to test all the possible combinations. I would really like to encourage every one of you who has some use case for that to try some of that stuff, report bugs, try it with different guests, so we can get a lot more coverage that way. Because I can't do that on the Porter machines for different architectures. For example, PPC, it's not possible on the Porter machines because you need root access, you're restarting the machine, you get kernel crashes. They don't like that on the Debian Porter machines. So if someone has access to that hardware, can run those tests, that would be really helpful. Yeah.
I also want to make a call for help for the QMU package. There is currently a team, but it seems currently I'm the only one working on that. So I would like to find some co-maintainers. So if someone is interested, please come talk with me.
Yeah. Any questions?
Yeah, the current situation with Xen is basically that we only have the kernel supporting the supporting the edge kernel.
Yes.
So next, when we switch to Lenny, hopefully soon, the only way to keep running our Xen servers will be to use that kernel.
Yes.
And is there any because the problems that I don't remember his name mentioned is basically that the development forked too far from mainline kernel, and that's why Xen hasn't been merged back in.
Yeah. So the Xen developers started designing their own virtualization interface,
mm-hmm.
and they are the only ones that use it. And right now, in the Linux kernel, there is this paravert ops interface, which the old Xen patches don't support.
In words, they didn't do that interface, but they basically
that didn't even add an interface, but instead they claimed they were new architecture supported by Linux. Think of like PowerPC x86 and then Xen, which was at that time, of course, only Xen on x86. So this would have duplicated even more if they had more architectures. And we kind of developers said this is really not maintainable because 90% of that code is copy and pasted from x86 anyway. So we better have to find some interface. And that's what part of WordOps went. And that's what, well, KVM is running on. That's what the Xen DOMU support right in now is working on. That's what the strange VMware VMI binary blob runs on. And that's what they finally, after ignoring it for a year, have started porting their DOM0 to. But the problem is that, of course, just porting to this interface alone is not enough. There might be parts not yet covered by that interface because no one has done as strange and drug-induced things as the Xen developers did, or because it's, of course, not just an interface in the machine-specific code, but a lot of device drivers, which are very different from DOM0 versus DOMU. So it's still a lot of work. And the last time I saw the Red Hat patches, they were peeing all over the kernel tree. And that's something generally not looked upon very well.
Well, from what I've seen, well, and reinforcing what you're saying, Xen is was the great buzzword some years ago, but I think it's going to fade away because on one hand it's a lot of code duplication, it's much dirtier, and well, you were asking what should we do with our Xen hosts after Lenny released. I think the easiest way out will be to advise our users when it's possible to migrate to a. I mean, when they're using full virtualization, the best thing is to migrate to KVM. Other users maybe migrate to vServer. Why? Because in the end, they are much cleaner. In the end, instead of adding an extra operating system, well, the hypervisor is just that. Well, the approach is quite saner, in my opinion. Of course, there's many things that Xen does offer that is not integrated in other solutions, but I think that's what's already happening by itself. So.
The way it's right now, the switch, at least for the Lenny release, will be quite hard for all the people using Xen, because KVM only runs on machines which have this hardware support, and it's not as stable yet as the Xen on Edge was. And if you need to run, for example, Windows, then, or systems where power virtualization is not easy, then Xen, then KVM right now isn't really a full replacement for Xen.
So, I mean, if you have the virtualization capable hardware, it actually is a pretty neat migration part, and that part that you already mentioned, that's Xener, which works very well. But about the stability, I don't know. I've only heard that stability argument from people who are not actually using it. So I use KVM on my development and traveling laptop the time, because that's where I have my virtual machines and where I do all the kernel testing, file system testing, distributions in. And I never, ever had a single KVM-related incident in the last year and a half.
I mean stability-wise from the source code side, because there's still a lot of change going on.
But even that is not a problem because the user space is backwards compatible. So I still have a KVM user space from over a year ago, and I just put the new mainline kernels on it. I just run one build yesterday, and it still works perfectly.
Yeah, so we probably need Xener support in Debian soon.
And the other part is, like, this is why me as back then in Edge times part of the kernel team was very unhappy that Edge released at all with Xen, because I was expecting exactly that no one can be bothered to maintain it anymore. It was shipped anyway, and now we have the debacle, and we'll see that same debacle with the vServer and OpenVZ and whatever Valdi wants to push in, because that's just not going to be maintained at some point anymore. So everyone who's thinking about it, I would strongly recommend against starting to use it, at least for a production system. Yeah. For playing around, it's perfectly fine, of course.
Hello. Right now, I'm in the process of updating the Debian kernel handbook for Lenny, And if people who know about this stuff would like to write a paragraph or a chapter for the handbook to document the current situation with Xen, that would be a very good contribution.
Where can you be reached?
That's yuri@debian.org.
Yeah, something else? No? Then thanks for your attention.